Sabbath greetings to everyone. We are delighted that you are here worshiping with us today. We are here in the junior high room, Pastor Doug's facilities. He has quite a few Christmas trees. You only see a couple of 13 here in the room. So if you would like to see the lights and everything, go down to the courtyard, look up to his window. You'll see something truly magnificent. We have a few announcements today. Why don't you start us off, Stu? Shut me down here.
Yeah, we're really
excited. Talking too much.
It was pretty exciting about Christmas. And speaking of Christmas, we've been talking about it for several weeks. This is the last week for the season's greeting. That's an opportunity to support the music ministry. Call the church office for that. This is the last week. And then also we're extremely excited that this year we're actually able to have the Christmas concert in person. Now, one thing to note, we mentioned it last week, we don't normally stream the Christmas concert just because it is a ticketed event and it's an opportunity to support the music ministry. But under the current circumstances with the COVID, et cetera, we are streaming it, and if you're blessed by it, you'll have an opportunity online to actually also support the music ministry. And then just one more treat, during the worship service, we're going to get to hear one of the guest vocalists that's going to be in the Christmas concert this evening at 4 or 6:30. So be looking for that as well.
Next week, December the 18th, we have our Handel's Messiah. We're so excited about this. It's a time when all of us can participate in the holiday season. And so this is what we need you to do. If you have the Handel's Messiah in a book form with the music, the words, please bring that, because the books will not be provided. And if you're anything like me, you need the words. Otherwise, you're just gonna be humming along. And also, if you would like to sing with the choir, you have that opportunity. You can call the music department, ask for Brenda, and you next week could be up on the stage with the choir singing your little hearts out. So we are looking forward to this very special experience next week.
It's always very, very moving, and we haven't been able to do it. So really encourage you to, you can either be just in the congregation, but if you want to sing, because some are going to be singing from the pew and some on the platform, so it's just going to be great.
Where are you going to be singing from? That's the question.
I'm going to do my media thing, and I'll just be humming maybe.
Behind the camera?
Exactly. Okay. And then finally, we just don't want you guys to forget about the senior newsletter. If you're wondering what's going on with the senior ministry, go to our website and sign up for the senior newsletter. It always has the latest information, so check that out.
That's it for everything that's going on here at the church the next couple of weeks. If you want to find out more information about events or things that are happening, go to our website, LLUC.org. There's a bulletin online as well. You can get information there.
We're just so glad you're worshiping with us today, and we hope you are blessed.
We love you guys. Have a great day.
Thank you. Amen. We love having this brass up here. Thank you so much. We're also excited that Pro Musica is with us today, and so we want to welcome them. But I also want to welcome our church. Friends, it's good to be with you. It is wonderful to be at church together. And, you know, we like to say something here, and some of you maybe are brand new to Adventism or this community, but we like to say Happy Sabbath. And if you're from another community, you might say Sabbat Ferishit, or you might say Feliz Sabado, or you might say Sretna Subota, or you might say Shabbat Shalom. So friends, we're so glad that you're here on the Sabbath day. We pray that God would bless you, that He would speak into your lives, and that you would feel His hope today with Pastor Randy's sermon and the beautiful music that you'll see. And so friends watching online, we want to welcome you as well. Thank you for joining us and calling us your family as well. God bless you, and may you feel the presence of Jesus today.
Shepherds too, the angels song, the shepherds too, Gloria in excelsis Deo, Gaudeamus, Gaudeamus. Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Today we'll be lighting the third candle of Advent. We look to Jesus, the light of the world and the center of our joy.
When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. They then opened their treasures and presented him with the gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Matthew 2, 10, 11.
Just as the wise men were overjoyed when they saw the star, they were overjoyed by a God that gives us peace in the midst of the troubled world we live in. This Advent, we ask for God's mercy and a joyful new beginning.
Let us pray. Dear God, we give thanks that you sent us your Son to save us. May our lives be overjoyed with the presence of your Son, Jesus Christ. Please lead us to your light. Fill us with your joy. Amen.
Thank you. For prayer this morning. Father in heaven, what a glorious Sabbath it is to be here together in your presence. It's a blessing, it's a privilege to be here. And Lord, as we are gathered here in the sanctuary and to those that are gathered in their homes and various places around the world, Lord, we come together and we give you our hearts. You don't care what we look like. You're not concerned about all the gifts and the talents and the shoes we have on and our cars and our homes. Lord, what you are concerned with and what matters to you is our hearts. And you are the only one who knows exactly what is in our hearts. And so this morning, Lord, we want to give you our hearts and we ask, Lord, that you would convict us of anything that is going on inside of our hearts right now that we need to turn over to you. Lord, forgive us of our pride. Forgive us of anything that comes in between our relationship with you and our relationship with others. And so right now we just surrender our hearts to you. And Lord, you also know the burdens that we carry. You know the joys and the celebrations that we've had this last week. We all come with such different journeys over the course of this last week. And Lord, we just ask that you would help us in our walks. Help us not to get so excited and happy with our lives that we don't think we need you. And help us not to be in such despair and at such a loss of hope that we can't turn to you and come on bended knee before you and bring our petitions to you. So, Lord, we give you everything today. We thank you for this season, the Advent season, and what it means and what it represents. Help us always, Lord, to keep hope in our heart because you love us and care for us deeply. We also want to remember today specifically the tornadoes that touched down all last night and this morning with family and friends on the East Coast. Lord, you know what's going on there. Please make your presence known. Lord, be with us the rest of this service. We worship you and we love and adore you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. You know, I love Christmas. Stu, I have been listening to Christmas music since October 31. I know. Who's with me? Raise them high. Good. Good. Well, you know, the greatest way to be involved in the Christmas spirit is to give gifts, to be in that gift-giving mode. Jesus Christ gave us so many gifts. So, friends, this is our gift-giving period of our worship. We want to say thank you for supporting the ministries here at Loma Linda University Church with your tithes and your offerings. And you know that next Sabbath, December 18, is our special Sabbath where we've asked you to make a significant gift, if you will, to our building program. And I am here with Pastor Stu Hardy, who is part of the new building. Your whole department is there, isn't it?
Yeah, we actually have an office. I actually have an office. When I was in the house, I didn't even have an office. I just was in the living room there.
So. I'm so glad.
Also, it was very providential in terms of the building because with the whole COVID thing, of course, none of us could plan on that. We were able to start meeting a little earlier. If you remember, some of you came out. We met in the courtyard. And then Anthem was able to meet in the amphitheater.
That's right.
And then last year, before we'd moved into the building, we were able to start filming our Christmas concert. Now, thank goodness we're going to be in person this year. That's
Amen.
Great.
Amen.
Then our studio facility, before we were able to move into the building earlier, so we were able to do announcements, Pastor Randy preaching.
That's right.
We did some special things there. And then just this last week, we did announcements in the junior high room with all those Christmas trees.
We loved having you there. Friends, there is no department that has benefited more from our new Family Ministries building. Yeah. And there's no department that has put out the worship service, our worship service, our signature of this community on online and our presentation on a broadcast. And friends, we're so thankful for the media and Stu. And I've heard from everybody how much they've appreciated the media's worship. And we appreciate what you've done there. Friends, if you'll remember our giving this giving season, I want to report to you, I know that the little graphic on the back of the bulletin doesn't seem to be moving. A lot is happening that we haven't just been able to reflect on that, and we'll update that very soon. But October and November, friends, was marvelous. It was just marvelous, and we will report that. So thank you so very much for being a part of this church and all of its ministries, including the media and the new Family Ministries building, because God is doing a great thing as we build for His kingdom.
Amen.
Family, come right on over and listen. We'll make sure we have room for your hubby, the three kids, and Auntie Nessa on the end. It's a delight to have the privilege of dedicating little Miles this morning. Miles is a month old today, so this is a special Sabbath day in the Olton family. That's Anthony, this is Alyssa, and way over there, that's Riley, and then Dad has Dakota. And then this is little Miles. So a month old, a year old, 2 years old, and I'm exhausted. So I asked, tell me what it's like at your home. How is it having three little ones? And they said, we're playing zone defense because we're outnumbered. We've just got too many of them. So Auntie Nessa was gracious enough to come up this morning and to give a hand here. Anthony and Alyssa are both graduates of Loma Linda University. They graduated with in the Department of Orthotics and Prosthetics, and that's the field in which they work now, up in the Northwest, up near Kirkland, Washington. Up there is where, Alyssa, you have family, and Anthony has family here in Loma Linda. In fact, Anthony was dedicated here at this church, so he's following in the footsteps. They are following in his footsteps here this morning. It's the Olton family is a family that has been a deep and a real part of this community and this church. Gary, you've blessed our family in so many ways. We're so grateful to you as well as the rest of the family. And then Alyssa, your family is not able to be here today, but they're viewing on the broadcast up near Kirkland, Washington. And so I'm going to have family and friends here in the congregation stand and also invite you at home in Kirkland, Washington to stand as well. If you are friends and loved ones of this little precious Miles. It's great to see each of you down here toward the back as well, over the sides. Wonderful. We're delighted to have you here, not only because you're showing your special support for Miles' dedication today, but also because you will be key in this young boy's, in these young girls, in this family's life in all the years to come. So you may be seated. As we talked, a child dedication is a special act. It's a meaningful act because we're walking in the footsteps of so many who have gone before. All the way back deep into the Old Testament, continuing in the New, parents brought their little ones to dedicate them to God. And I think the most precious moment, Anthony and Alyssa, is that moment when the mothers brought their little ones to Jesus, asking Jesus to bless them, to lay his hands on them. Now, there were people like me around that day and maybe two or three of these here who said, no, leave him alone. He's preaching. And Jesus said, wait, what are you talking about? This is what my kingdom is made up of, these little ones. They were precious and dear to his heart, and they continue to be precious and dear to his heart. So that's why we come, church family, every opportunity we have to bring little ones in dedication to Jesus. Now, I told the parents when we talked this week, this is not only a dedication of little Miles, this is a dedication of mom and dad as well, and even the two older sisters, because y'all are going to need some insight, some wisdom, some love, and especially some patience as the little ones grow up. So that's what we come to do in prayer today. I'd like to read mom's and dad's words regarding this dedication moment. Their prayer for Miles. They say, we pray that Miles grows up with knowledge of and faith in God and has a desire to dedicate himself to service. We hope he finds fulfillment in whatever direction his life takes him. We pray he will have constant love around him and in his heart. Finally, we wish him the ability to find happiness in all the little things so joy will always fill his life. Mommy and Daddy. Isn't that a wonderful prayer? A great prayer for a little boy. Now, Alyssa, I'm going to take him from you. Let me see if I can... There we go. Miles, you are just a little one. What a delight to have you here. Let's pray together and dedicate Miles to Jesus. Lord, what a delight and what a joy it is to have this precious little bundle of life in my arms. We're always filled with wonder and awe that as human beings, you've given us the joy of co-participating in the creation of life. Lord, little Miles, a month old today, has his life stretched out before him. We pray that you would walk with him and go with him all the days of his life, that your Spirit would bless him, that your love would fill him, and that your wisdom would guide him. We pray this blessing not only upon Miles, but on Riley and Dakota, on Mom and Dad, upon grandmas and grandpas, all the family who stood, and on our church, that we might be a safe place where children can learn to love Jesus. Thank you for these blessings. Bless Miles today is our prayer. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. God bless you in rich and wonderful ways. I'll carry him out if that's okay. Dark midnight was my cry. Dark midnight was my cry. Dark midnight was my cry. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus.
Lord, give me Jesus.
Good morning, church family. Our scripture today is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 67 through 79.
His father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, "Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come to his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he said through his holy prophets of long ago, salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy to our ancestors and to remember his holy covenant. The oath he swore to our father Abraham, to rescue us from the hand of our enemies and to enable us to serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all our days.
And you, my child, will be called a prophet of the Most High, for you will go on before the Lord to prepare the way for him, through the forgiveness of their sins because of the tender mercy of our God, by which the rising sun will come to us from heaven to shine on those living in darkness and in the shadow of death to guide our feet into the path of peace."
Those of us who follow Jesus have a problem. It's a very real problem. The problem is captured in this line of truth about the people of God. Throughout time, the people of God have had to learn to wait. And that's a problem, because I don't like to wait. In fact, come to think of it, I can't name a single person I've met who has said to me, "I love waiting." It seems that none of us like to wait. And it doesn't even have to do with age. I can remember back when I was a student in college. I don't know if it was just a campus legend or if it was actual fact, but it was said that if the teacher didn't get into the classroom, by the time it was 10 after the start time, you could leave and not be counted absent. I remember sitting in class many times hoping, "Oh, it's five after, maybe, we're almost there." And then the teacher would show up. We don't like to wait. In fact, thinking about class and not liking to wait reminds me of what my friend Jerry Winslow says. He says, "School is the only reality I can think of which, when we get less than what we paid for, we're happy." I mean, just imagine if you bought a ticket from L.A. to New York and you got on and the pilot announced, "We've decided we're only going as far as Kansas City." These days, you'd have a riot on your hands. But if the teacher says, "We're canceling class tomorrow," everybody cheers. But I digress. Waiting. We don't like to wait. In fact, stay with the airline illustration. Suppose we're flying back from the East Coast back to SoCal. And we're sitting at the airport waiting to board, and they announce with those dreaded words, "The flight has been delayed." Oh, great. How long? And over a period of time, they make an announcement after an announcement until finally, 3 hours in, people are fuming mad and are saying, "I'm going to miss my connections. It's going to mess everything up." And sure enough, we get on 3 hours late, get to Dallas to make our connection. We've missed that connection. We wait another 3 hours, get home 6 hours late, and everything is spoiled. We're in a bad mood, we missed the dinner appointment, we've upset all kinds of things, the airline didn't pay for our food, they weren't that apologetic, and we're mad because we had to wait. Never mind the fact that had we made that same journey 200 years ago, it would have taken months. People would have died on the way. We would have been different people by the time we arrived. But today, I'm mad because I had to wait 6 hours. We don't like to wait. Calls to mind the words of a Christian psychologist named Kim Hall. who in an interview said this: "People seem to believe that they have an inalienable right to be happy. I want what I want, and I want it now. No one wants to wait for anything, and for the most part, no one has to wait anymore. Waiting is interpreted as pain. People walk into my office and say they're Christians, but I see no difference except they want to be happy now and expect God to make it so. The problem is, in this country, you can have what you want when you want it most of the time. People like the fact that they can buy a 50-foot tree and instantly plant it in their yard. Why on earth would anyone want to wait on relationships or wait on God? In an instant world, we don't want to wait. And yet there's a problem if we follow Jesus because of the simple fact that throughout time, the people of God have had to learn to wait. Just consider some of God's all-stars. Abraham. Abraham waited and waited and waited. You're going to have an heir. And he waited. When the gray began to fleck his beard, he said, "God, you know, I got this servant here. He's a good man. I could adopt him." God says, "Nope, it's going to be through you." And he waited. When the gray began to fleck Sarah's hair, he said, "God, please." And Sarah said, "Here, take my maid, and we can raise that child as though it's ours." Wrong decision. See the Arab-Israeli conflict for evidence. And Abraham waited. Abraham looked out the tent flap, and there came Sarah by on her walker. And he said, "God, I know what it is to wait, but this is ridiculous." Abraham waited. Moses waited. God said to Moses, "I want you to lead my people from bondage to freedom, from Egypt to Canaan." Moses immediately went out and offed an Egyptian and then fled for his life. Said, "What next, God?" And he said, "God said, I want you to follow these sheep around in this wilderness. For how long? I'll let you know. 1 decade, 2 decades, 3 decades, 4. And he's still waiting. Moses waited. And what about Elijah? That blood and guts prophet Elijah. Show and tell Elijah. Hide and seek Elijah. Sit by the creek while it dries up Elijah. Elijah knew what it was to wait. And even Jesus. Have you paused to ponder that? He came to save the world, and yet we know very little about the first 30 years of his life. 30 years. It seems like if your task is to save the world, you probably ought to get at it. 30 years. Oh, there are some traditions, some old traditions, that say Jesus worked in the carpenter shop and made the best ox yokes in all of Palestine. In fact, one tradition said there was a sign hung above his carpenter shop that said, "My yokes fit well." They still do, by the way. But come on, ox yokes? When you're here to save the planet? 30 years? Waiting. It's a problem. Especially for those of us who live in an instant world. A 50-foot tree here today that wasn't there yesterday world. The people of God have always waited. And then we come to Zechariah. Zechariah and his prayer. It's the third prayer of Advent, the Benedictus, the blessing. It's found in Luke's Gospel, chapter 1, but first a bit of context. You remember Zechariah. Zechariah, the aged priest with an aging wife, barren. Zechariah, who in the midst of his ministry encounters the angel who gives him the good news, a child. Zechariah, who doesn't believe it, and Zechariah, who is struck mute for the next 9 months. Eugene Peterson says, for those 9 months, the word grew within Zechariah. It grew until finally 9 months later, at the blessing of this child who was born, at the naming of this child, finally those words are born. They're birthed. They explode into life. And when he speaks them, he's been saving them up. It's clear that Zechariah has been pondering, thinking, and praying about this child. Because he'll say some remarkable things about this child that is to be born. It's just a baby, probably 8 days old at this point in time. Family says, name him Zacharias. Mom says, no, John. They said, no, you don't have anybody by that name in your family. What do you want him? And when he pins the word John, his tongue is loosed. And he begins to pray, to sing the Benedictus. I want you to notice as we read it that there's a note of exhilaration in his words. There are tones of accomplishment, of fulfillment, of completion. God has acted. God has moved. The long wait is over. The child, the forerunner of the Messiah, has arrived. Now, as we read the Benedictus, I want you to notice that it comes in two parts. The first part is about the nation of Israel, about God's moves among his people. There are no doubt tones of political salvation here. Some even say he's wrong because he's thinking the time has come for Israel to be delivered from her political foes. Yes, you can read that here. But if you read carefully, there's more than that. He uses terms like mercy and peace and righteousness. He doesn't have the full picture, but he has some of it. That's the first part. The second part of the prayer is about the child. What this child will do and what his father Zechariah prays over him, just like we prayed over Miles a few moments ago, his father has grand visions for what this child will do and accomplish. And so we read the third prayer of Advent, the Benedictus, Luke chapter 1, beginning in verse 67. His father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, "Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come to his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he said through his holy prophets long ago, salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy to our ancestors, to remember his holy covenant, the oath he swore to our father Abraham, to rescue from the hand of our enemies and to enable us to serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, my child, will be called a prophet of the Most High. For you will go on before the Lord to prepare the way for him, to give his people the knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of their sins, because of the tender mercy of our God, by which the rising sun will come to us from heaven to shine on those living in darkness and in the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the path of peace." The Benedictus, praise be to God. You're waiting on something. I don't know what it is, but I can probably accurately guess that you're waiting on something. It may be you've been waiting for a partner in life. You've been praying for a long time. Years ago, it started out with praying for tall, dark, and handsome. Now you'll take short, any color and breathing. But you're still praying. Praying that somehow, God, in fact, you say, God, it's in your word. You said it's not good for the man. It's not good for the woman to be alone. So, well, and here you sit today waiting. Praying for a job. Lord, I'm watching my savings account dwindle. Lord, you have to provide. something. I spent years in education. I need something by which to provide for myself, provide for my family. Lord, I read it in your word. Paul, writing to his Philippian friends, says right there, and my God will supply all your needs according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. God, I'm asking, I'm pleading, I'm waiting. Well, and here you sit today, waiting. Maybe it's for healing, a grim diagnosis, and you've gone to your knees, day after week after month, on your knees. God, I'm just asking, just this favor. I mean, you can do it like you did when you walked the dusty roads of Galilee, just a touch of the hand in response to the query of faith. You can do it in my life. Or if you'd rather not do it that way, then use our good physicians, our nurses, our scientists. But whatever mechanism you use, please grant me life. And here you sit today, waiting. Zechariah and his people knew what it was to wait. From Adam's sin to Malachi's pen, the entire Old Testament is the story of a people looking forward, yearning, hoping, pleading, longing, praying, waiting. But the Benedictus, the passage we have just read today, is not really about waiting. It is, but it's not. It's about waiting only in the sense that the final culmination has come. That hoped-for Messiah was on the horizon. This child would be his forerunner. That's why when we read the Benedictus, it begins with that eulogy, that praise to God. Blessed be God, because finally God has acted. A child has arrived that will prepare the way before the Messiah. If we were to draw on C.S. Lewis's images from the Chronicles of Narnia, he would say, Aslan is on the move. God is about to act. And that's why Zechariah is filled with praise. In fact, if we wanted to summarize Zechariah's Benedictus, his song of praise, his prayer of praise, if we wanted to summarize it in three words, we could say it is these: it is happening. It is happening. If we wanted to summarize it in two words, we could say almost here. If we wanted to summarize it in one word, it would be the word final. Finally, finally, after all the millennia, all the centuries, all the decades, all the years, finally, God has acted. Finally. In fact, he joins Mary. You remember the Fiat Mihi, Mary's first prayer of Advent? Her answer to God's will you, summarized in one word, yes. Mary's second prayer, the Magnificat, as it dawned on her, I will be the one that God will use, a one-word descriptor, me. And now Zechariah, at the realization that it's actually happening, one-word prayer, finally. It's a prayer of praise, adoration, and joy. Eugene Peterson says, in these prayers, we join those around the throne of God. We join the conversation of the ages. We join what the people of God have prayed over and over and over again. And yet I realize that today, this third prayer, the Benedictus, may not yet be a prayer that can escape your lips. It's a joyous prayer of anticipation fulfilled, of peace in the soul, of joy at the gift. Finally. It's a prayer we yearn to pray. It's a prayer that doesn't get prayed often enough. In fact, along those lines, and because it's Christmas, maybe it's time for a story. A story that comes from many years ago, actually. A story from shortly after World War II. A story from that time when the world was devastated and people yearned to have their waiting fulfilled. It was a story that was written by Howard Schade, but it was picked up by my professor of English when I was in college, Joe Wheeler. Dr. Wheeler included it in one of his Christmas in My Heart books. It's called The Gold and Ivory Tablecloth. It's a story about waiting, slow, painful, agonizing waiting. It's one of the most treasured stories of Christmas. Though it seems fictional, apparently true. Here's what Howard Schade wrote. At Christmas time, men and women everywhere gather in their churches to wonder anew at the greatest miracle the world has ever known. But the story I like best to recall was not a miracle. Not exactly. It happened to a pastor who was very young. His church was very old. Once long ago, it had flourished. Famous men had preached from its pulpit, prayed before its altar. Rich and poor alike had worshiped there and built it beautifully. Now the good days had passed from the section of town where it stood, but the pastor and his young wife believed in their rundown church. They felt that with paint, hammer, and faith, they could get it into shape. So together, they went to work. But in late December, a severe storm whipped through the river valley, and the worst blow fell on the little church. A huge chunk of rain-soaked plaster fell out of the inside wall just behind the altar. Sorrowfully, the pastor and his wife swept away the mess, but they couldn't hide the ragged hole. The pastor looked at it and had to remind himself quickly, "Thy will be done." But his wife wept. Christmas is only 2 days away. That afternoon, the dispirited couple attended the auction held for the benefit of the youth group. The auctioneer opened a box and shook out of its fold a handsome gold and ivory lace tablecloth. It was a magnificent item, nearly 15 feet long, but it too dated from a long vanished era. Who today had any use for such a thing? There were a few half-hearted bids. Then the pastor was seized with a thought that he thought was a great idea. He bid it and bought it for $6.50. He carried the cloth back to the church and tacked it up on the wall behind the altar. It completely hid the hole. And the extraordinary beauty of its shimmering handwork cast a fine holiday glow over the chancel. It was a great triumph. Happily, he went back to preparing his Christmas sermon. Just before noon on the day of Christmas Eve, as the pastor was opening the church, he noticed a woman standing in the cold at the bus stop. "The bus won't be here for 40 minutes," he called, and invited her into the church to get warm. She told him that she had come from the city that morning to be interviewed, come to the city that morning to be interviewed for a job as a governess to the children of one of the wealthy families in town, but she had been turned down. A war refugee, her English was imperfect. The woman sat down in a pew and chafed and rubbed her hands and rested. After a while, she dropped her head and prayed. She looked up as the pastor began to adjust the great gold and ivory lace cloth across the hole. She rose suddenly and walked up the steps of the chancel. She looked at the tablecloth. The pastor smiled and began to tell her about the storm damage, but she didn't seem to listen. She took up a fold of the cloth and rubbed it between her fingers. "It's mine," she said. "It's my banquet cloth." She lifted up a corner and showed the surprised pastor that there were initials monogrammed on it. "My husband had the cloth made for me, especially in Brussels. There could not be another like it." For the next few minutes, the woman and the pastor talked excitedly together. She explained that she was Viennese, that she and her husband had opposed the Nazis and had decided to leave the country. They were advised to go separately, so her husband put her on a train for Switzerland. They planned that he would join her as soon as he could arrange to ship their household goods across the border. She never saw him again. Later, she heard that he had died in a concentration camp. "I've always felt it was my fault to leave without him," she said. "Perhaps these years of wondering, these years of waiting, have been my punishment." The pastor tried to comfort her, urged her to take the cloth with her. She refused, and then she went away. As the church began to fill on Christmas Eve, it was clear that the cloth was going to be a great success. It had been skillfully designed to look its best by candlelight. After the service, the pastor stood at the doorway. Many people told him that the church looked beautiful. One gentle-faced, middle-aged man, he was the local clock and watch repairman, looked rather puzzled. "It is strange," he said in his soft accent. "Many years ago, my wife, God rest her, and I owned such a cloth. In our home in Vienna, my wife put it on the table," and he said this part with a smile, "only when the bishop came to dinner." The pastor suddenly became very excited. He told the jeweler about the woman who had been in church earlier that day. The startled jeweler clutched the pastor's arm. "Can it be? Does she live?" Together, the two got in touch with the family who had interviewed her. Then in the pastor's car, they started for the city. And as Christmas Day was born, this man and his wife, who had been separated through so many saddened Yuletides, were reunited. Their long separation, their agonizing wait, had ended. I don't know what sorrow you have in your soul today. I do know that sorrow is made worse at Christmas. I don't know what it is you wait for today. I do know that the people of God have waited throughout the ages. I don't know how long you'll wait. Only God knows how long. But I do know this: the wait will end. Fulfillment will come. I do know that the prayers of God's people throughout the ages have included Zechariah's prayer. I do know that the Benedictus will come. And I also know that whenever it does come, the most joyful prayer you will ever pray is Zechariah's prayer. The Benedictus, the third prayer of Advent, that joyful, praise-filled, one-word prayer. Finally. Gracious God, we yearn to pray that prayer. We have long waited. We have long petitioned. We have long longed. Lord, please, this Advent season, this Christmas time of year, might someone in this congregation pray the third prayer of Advent, finally, in Jesus' name, amen.
another bright hello this Sabbath day to all of you. So glad to have you with us. A lot more interesting people to tell you about.
I begin greetings today with my classmate from Walla Walla College, Dr. George Cafruni, White Salmon, Washington, in La Cañada, California. There he is on the right with another classmate of mine from Walla Walla, Dr. Bob Sprode. And we're greeting Dr. George Cafruni for his birthday. All the very best, George. And another doctor, Reg Rice, Placerville, California. And wish you a very happy birthday as well, Reg. And enjoy hearing about your orchard and your garden. Congratulations. Mike Edge, Calhoun, Georgia. And there you are with Juanita, your wife, and with Zach Payne at Camp Wakanda, Wisconsin, where you spent years and years of your ministry in youth work and then as conference president. Congratulations on your birthday, Mike. Hello, Peter Farrell, Mississauga, Ontario, Canada. Happy birthday, sir. So glad to be reminded and to see you there with your lovely wife, Liz. And another, Ethan Hutchinson, also from Mississauga, Ontario, Canada, 19 years old. Congratulations, Ethan, and so glad to learn about your birthday. And the same goes for Zion Grant, Toronto, Ontario, 15th birthday. Congratulations, Zion, and I'm glad to know about your birthday as well. And that goes for Larry Evans, too. Laurel, Maryland now, I think. Hello, Larry. Congratulations on your birthday as I see you with your lovely wife. And Jim McKinstry. We have lots of history, too. You're over in Murray, Utah, I'm told. And this is your 94th birthday. Warmest congratulations, Jim. And look at this man, Joe Humble, with his wife, Patricia, in College Place, Washington, Joe's 87th birthday, really? Joe and I were together at Walla Walla College as well. And I wish you all the best, Joe, and so glad to see you there with Pat. Loretta Koenig at the Villa, right here, Loma Linda, 99th birthday, Loretta. We enjoy at least seeing each other and reminding each other that somehow we've got to be related. I'll accept that. Congratulations, Loretta. Alina James, Bish, Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, 4 years old. Look at this darling little lady. Congratulations, Alina. Hello, Phil Reiswig, Beaumont, California, part of our University Church family. 87th birthday, Phil. All the best to you, your niece there with you, and of course, your lovely wife, Joyce, who I call my sister because we share a birthday. And he loves his great-granddaughter so much. Linda Graham, Essex, England. Hello, Linda. Happy birthday to you. And so glad to see you there with daughter, Dr. Michelle Sancho. Hello, Betty Adams, Placerville, California. 91st birthday. And there you are with your newest grandson and also with your son, Fred. And speaking of Fred, Fred has a birthday about now, too. And glad to see you, Fred, and there with your wife as well. Congratulations to the Adams family. Hello, Gary Golden. Glad to know about your birthday and wish I could see you Sabbath by Sabbath as we used to. But I'm still glad to know about your birthday and see you there with Barry and with Sonova. Bruce McClay, Orchards, Washington, 78th birthday. And there you are with wife Mary. I've so enjoyed knowing about your life and your ministry there in Orchards. Hello, Ellen Hickman, right here at University Church. There you are with dear Tim. Congratulations, Ellen. Glad to be where you are anytime. And Brandon Wolf, the same goes for you. Brandon, 21st birthday. And so much appreciate you at the University Church and all the ministry you do. And I see you're a sailor. And you're also graduating. Hello, Donna Carlson. Glad to know about your birthday, too, and get to see you there with Dr. Jeff, your husband, as the two of you were sharing some time down San Diego way. But anyway, happy birthday, Donna. Hello, Kelly Bach. Over Maryland way these days, I understand, on special assignment. But there you are with the women in your life, your wife, Diana, and your girls.
And hello to George Gaynor and his precious wife. George, of course, is the pastor at Happy Valley, Oregon. And there they are with their children. Congratulations, George.
Hello, John Scharfenberg. Dr. John, so glad to talk to you recently. 98th birthday, sir. And I hear you are an important part of Winter Wednesday at University Church come February. And then in March, you have an assignment to Europe where you'll do more health lectures. Congratulations on your birthday and on your ministry, John. Hello, Jody and Ellis Rogers. Yes, you're having a special anniversary. I think it's your 52nd. But most important, these two are really the leaders of the quilting ministry at University Church. So I congratulate you on both counts, Jody and Ellis. Hello, Stu. Stu Harty. Yes, everybody who sees university programs knows you, Stu. And I know it's your birthday right about now. And I ask everybody to join me with warm greetings as I see you there with precious Linda and then your boys, Eric and Andrew. And a big hello to you, Judy Gillespie. Happy birthday over Riverside Way. So glad to be reminded. And Joyce Wilson, Battle Creek, Michigan. 73rd birthday, Joyce. Warmest congratulations to you, and I'm so glad your friends let me know. And the same goes for Winona Astrup, Lincoln, Nebraska. 93rd birthday, Winona. And so glad to know about your birthday and that you join us every Sabbath here at University Church. Hello, Bill Gerber, Abbotsford, British Columbia. Now, there are lots of things Bill Gerber does, and there are lots of pictures of him, but I think the best ones are of Bill Gerber as grandpa to these darling little girls. Congratulations, Bill. Ernie Castillo, wow, we've been friends about forever, I think. And glad to know about your birthday. And I'm glad to tell the folks you are a part of senior ministry at University Church. And a big hello now to Walt and Darlene Hammerslow, Louisville, Colorado, 60th anniversary. There they were. And there they are. See what 60 years has produced. And they reminded me that we were together in Eugene, Oregon, 50 years ago when I was the pastor there.
Hey, happy birthday, Dick Taggart. 86th birthday, I hear, up there Medford Way. So delighted to be reminded of your birthday and to see you there with dear Peggy and that great-granddaughter, Emmy Olivia Ashlock. How about that? Congratulations.
Hello, Pastor Fearing. There with his dear wife, 94th birthday, and with his darling daughter, Jane. Congratulations, sir. Pastor Fearing, great preacher. Amazing memory. He remembered things about me that I had forgotten. Anyway, congratulations, Pastor Fearing.
Yes, one more time. I'm so grateful for each Sabbath we have. And another reminder, this December is a busy time, but today is particularly interesting. We have the Christmas concert. Hope you'll join us.